Listen, Lou, I think we should talk. We've been seeing an awful lot of each other lately, and I really think it's in my best interest if I went out with someone more popular, better looking, drives a nicer car, and doesn't have those long monkey arms.
Would you like to learn from those that are taking their lives, their businesses, and their passions to the next level? Best-selling author of Speakeasy and Master Connector, Lou Diamond is here to connect you to some of the most inspiring and amazing people on this planet. Get ready to thrive loud with Lou Diamond.
Welcome, everyone, to another unbelievable, spectacular, fantastic, awesome episode of Thrive Loud with Lou Diamond, connecting you with the most inspiring and amazing people that are thriving each and every day. I'm your host, Lou Diamond, and today on Thrive Loud, we have a nonprofit business strategist, number one international best-selling author, and former executive director. She is the creator of the Impact Method, a framework that helps nonprofits simplify their operations, build aligned teams, and make a bigger impact without getting overwhelmed or burning out. We have the founder and heart behind PivotGround. We're going to talk about all of these things in this lovely conversation. So Thrive Loud listeners, I bring you Sarah Olivieri. Sarah, how are you
today? I am so great today, and I'm super thrilled to be here. What a great introduction.
We try. I can't take really the much credit because, you know, we pull our information from all the incredible things that you do.
Well, you brought the energy.
That's our goal here, to have a lot of fun and highlight those that are thriving. So what I want to do, Sarah, is I want to go back a little bit, not all the way back. I want to go back to when this thing that you're doing right now, when it came to you that this is what you wanted to focus on and how it became your gig.
Yeah. Well, you know, sometimes you build your business and then sometimes something happens and then you're like catching up with it, right? So I built a business that was a marketing agency. And, you know, and I was like, I got a niche, and I niched into nonprofits because that's what I knew from my former background. And what I discovered was most nonprofits couldn't handle great marketing because they're a lot of them secretly are a little dysfunctional on the inside. A lot dysfunctional on the inside. And I had a client actually asked me if they would come and help, if I would come down to DC and help them reorganize their team. And I was like, oh my God, that sounds so much fun. And I had started to create systems for organizing just so that my clients could receive my marketing services. And in that moment, all of a sudden, I fell in love with helping nonprofits run better. But I already knew that just being a consultant wasn't going to cut it, because I'd already had that taste of like, when you go in and you give people your best ideas and you help them out, and then when you leave, they can't keep it going on their own. So I knew that I had to give them a solution that helped them come up with their own better ideas and help them run themselves better, and that wasn't so dependent on me. And that's how I created the Impact Method, which is really like a framework for running your business, your nonprofit as a business, and a framework for setting your goals and communicating. And we get into some of that so that it wouldn't just be me, and so that nonprofits, who I think are, you know, the most important businesses in the world, so that they could start making a bigger impact and they shouldn't be struggling from dysfunction.
I'm going to dive into this because this, I had a conversation the other day with someone about this, and I want to get your two cents. Nonprofit needs a rebranding. I say this because this show is genuinely usually on the cusp of extreme positivity, right? And even the word nonprofit, which is basically just saying, listen, we're not focused on a profit. We're focused on a cause, or we're focused on a purpose more so than we are a charitable organization, whatever it might be. Those are the nonprofits, and listeners who are thinking that's what it is. But because of its like tax classification, this is the bucket that it goes in. But many of these nonprofits, as you know, are massive organizations. Can be small, can be big, but it's not necessarily solely like this small little thing where we're just, you know, raising a few dollars and holding out a can. Some of these things are real well-established organizations. Let's go into this. Do you agree with me? There could be a rebranding that needs to happen for nonprofits.
Oh, absolutely. There are like 1.7 million nonprofits in the United States. So that's kind of, you know, a big chunk. And you know, many of them are teeny budgets under 250,000. I've had clients whose budgets were, you know, teens of millions. And, you know, and there are certainly many who are 50 million, they're $1 billion nonprofits. And so, yeah, so the amount of money they have in their bank or that they're generating every year, they're certainly allowed to have a profit. I think, you know, the real legal thing about being a nonprofit is no one is allowed to own a piece of a nonprofit and sell that piece for profit, right? But the nonprofit as an entity can have lots of profit, just has to reinvest it in itself or in salaries.
So I agree with what you said, though. I've done some business with some nonprofits, and more often than not, and maybe more often than regular profit-focused corporations, organizations, whatever, what have you, they're a little messy in the inside. You're yeah. Right. Okay, so let's do this right out of the gate. Why do we think they're always messy?
I'll give you two reasons.
Yeah.
I thought about this a lot. And the first reason, the most important reasons, is nonprofits as businesses are more complex than for-profits. Almost every nonprofit from day one, right? So if you know business, and just let's pretend I'm talking about for-profits. I said, you have to start a business, but you have to start with three business partners minimum. And you have to have at least two businesses that you're starting at the same time, or two main brand lines that you're starting at the same time. If I told you that you had to start like that, and you know about business, you'd be like, no way, Sarah, that's a recipe for disaster, right? And yet this is how nonprofits start. Legally, they're required to have at least three board members, and they have to, unless their services will fully pay for all of their operations, which is rarely the case because then they wouldn't go through the trouble of being a nonprofit. They have to build a fundraising business alongside some kind of service delivery business. And those have two different audiences and two different sets of messages at the same time. So it's very, very tricky business to run a nonprofit. And then you top reason number two, right? I said there are two reasons, is most people who are interested in running nonprofits are heart-driven, passionate people about their particular mission. They are not people who are in love with business and business operations and business strategy, which I am. And there are very few people like me. There's lots of people like me in the for-profit world, but there are very few people who are just fascinated by how business run, thinking about the nonprofit business as a type of business.
Sarah, what drove you to help these nonprofits? Is there something in you that it's not just trying to solve the problem, I have a feeling. I have a feeling there might be something behind that and what your interest is in helping those organizations.
Yeah, well, so many reasons. I mean, I come from that background, so I could really understand it. I love a good challenge. But you know what? At the end of the day, whenever something goes bad in the world, I get to say, am I making the biggest impact that I can make with my life? And I get to answer yes. Every time. I don't have to have like some sort of crisis of like, oh, I should be doing more to help the world, or I need to start writing, doing letter campaigns or picketing or something. Every day I work with executive directors at nonprofits and I'm helping them, you know, 2x, 10x the impact that they're making in all the thousands of people that they serve. And I feel very good about the impact I'm making.
I like how you described that you can go on a consulting project, do some work, then you leave. You made an impact when you were there. Maybe there was a short wave afterwards, and then it doesn't maintain that same focus and energy. This is what led you to create the impact method. Let's talk about what are you deploying at the impact method at these nonprofits that makes it easier for them to keep this more organized, more processed way of going and on an ongoing basis.
Sure. Well, I'll tell you, when I created the impact method, you know, I didn't make everything up in it from scratch. There are all these great methods for for-profits that have been developed, but usually they have either for-profit language 100% and somewhere in there, the assumption that you're trying to make a profit is baked in, and they don't necessarily address this two-prong business model thing, which I call mission pie and money pie, by the way. You know, I knew it had to be really simple because most nonprofits their leaders are suffering from overwhelm. So, you know, you take someone who's overwhelmed and give them something complicated, it's not really going to work. So there's a few key secrets to how this works. So I threw in like a dash of agile, if you know what agile is, or maybe you're more familiar with Scrum, right? So this kind of, and Kanban, this kind of, let's make it visual, let's see it. I learned a lot about planning when I was doing marketing. And one of the things I learned about planning is that the way you look at your plan can impact the way, how good it is. Just like visually, do you lay it out in a big spreadsheet? Is it written out in a big document? Is it in a mind map? And so I started creating simpler ways of visualizing your plan. So it's actually easier to make your plan and set better goals. And then one of the third things that makes it really simple is it's all tied together. So there was, I'm going to blank on the Rockefeller habits, I think. And then there's like all these different tools and strategies. And they tell you like, here's like 7 tools you can use, but you have to figure out how to stitch them together. In the impact method, I said, if executive directors have to figure out how to stitch tools together, they're not going to do it. And that was my biggest breakthrough, I think, was I tied all the tools together in specific types of meetings. So there's 3 types of meetings that teams have, and they all have very specific agendas. And the agendas tell them to use the tool. So simple, and yet it is the difference between doing it and not doing it.
Deploying this stuff into... In deploying the impact method into these companies, look, this, any organization, profit or nonprofit, getting a new process, getting a new system, getting a new reminder tool, getting whatever it is that keeps them on track into their current flow of operations is always challenging.
One, is that
consistent in the nonprofit world? And 2, how can you make it easier for them to deploy the impact method?
Yeah. So it is and it isn't true. So, you know, of course, if they have systems and you're trying to get them to change from one system to another, it's just like any for-profit business. Many, many nonprofits don't have any systems in place. So it's kind of like this different. And I'm not just talking about the teeny ones. I had a $13 million, 200 plus employee client who wasn't even regularly holding staff meetings. They had no internal systems of how we communicate or how we share a calendar, like some really, really basic stuff missing even in some large organizations. So then the challenge is more like getting people to feel like systems isn't a bad word. But once you show them a system, and one of the things we start doing is we have people rate. So they try the new thing and then they rate it. As on a scale of 1 to 4, how helpful was this meeting? And as soon as everyone's rating it a 4, then they're like, oh yeah, we actually like this. And it's usually the very first meeting they're giving it the highest rating. And so we get that kind of like adrenaline, excitement, you know, the little ping, like when you get, oh, success, you won. You won your first meeting. And really, because we need to keep it simple, the thing I tell people who are implementing is you schedule the meeting in your calendar, because we have to get people meeting with their teams, and then you hold the meeting and then you follow just the exact agenda that I hand you. So schedule it in your calendar, actually hold the meeting, follow the agenda. And if you can't do that, then you probably need some one-on-one leadership coaching.
You like processes. I could see this in here. She gets excited. She gets more excited about putting this stuff in. You love the processes. You love helping and working with these causal or these nonprofit organizations because there's a spirit in there that really is trying to, like you said, every day make the world a better place. You're leading your own company. You've written books. You wear a lot of hats. Sarah, what hat do you like wearing the most often? Which role in the work that you do is your favorite hat to put on each time you do it?
Oh, well, you know, as much as I like processes, I like to work with the leaders themselves. I like to see them have success. And as much as, you know, I'm all about the real lasting impact, kind of a win, internal win for me and for them is executive directors who get to take their first vacation in years. Maybe they start to raise their pay. You know, I've worked with executive directors who were not getting paid and we took them all the way up to like a market rate salary, which is still kind of low, maybe like in the 80,000, you know, so getting them paid just even a livable wage. I think it is just in the nonprofit sector, no nonprofit employee should be forced into poverty because of the nonprofit salary they're getting paid, right? Uh-huh. We can't be adding to the problems as people running nonprofits. And so just to have that personal impact and knowing that we always talk about like brain space with my clients, giving them that brain space, unlocking their visionary capabilities. To me, like getting them into that space is the most exciting part and lovingly, you know, telling them that that thing you're doing is the mistake and it's you causing that problem. And then having them receive that information, right? I know you've coached people. It is a tricky thing to tell people that they are the problem. But if you can do that, and then they can really change, what they can do after that is really amazing. And I love seeing that.
Sarah, my goal is when I'm dealing with top performers and leaders is to get them to admit that they're the problem, not me to tell them that they're the yeah. problem. I might ask them the question and it might drive out. I love asking guests on this program this question. I want to see where this goes. Look, this is a passion project that has become a passion business for you working with these nonprofits. And for those who get a chance to see some of the video clips, she's smiling ear to ear. So she loves what she does. She loves this environment, which means on most days you're thriving. And we'll talk about that in the plug section here, which has a little pun to this program and what you do. But on some days we're a little off our game. Sometimes we're dealing with the frustration of those in the nonprofit space. Sometimes things aren't clicking on all cylinders. Sarah, when you have trouble thriving, what practice do you seek, or maybe which individual do you seek out to get yourself back on the thriving track?
I'm a sailboat racer. And Ooh. When I go out sailing, it is crazy fun, but it is also terrifying. And it is my regular practice in facing fear in a way that I kind of control. Once I'm off the boat, the experience is over. And it's hard and it's dynamic. And in the winter, when I don't go sailing as much, I start to struggle a little more. I'm like, I need my sailing therapy. I just went yesterday. Actually, we pulled our boat out of the water this morning. So I think, and I always encourage my clients, right? You got to have stuff outside of what you do every day, because it gives you inspiration, it refreshes you. And for me, even after having the worst day, I get on the sailboat and sometimes I'm scared because the weather's bad or something and I get like nerves in my stomach. As soon as I'm out on the water, whether it's, you know, hot and there's no wind and we're just baking out there, or if it's blowing like crazy, just get the same big smile on my face. And I'm just like, it feels great. And I don't think about anything but sailing while I'm sailing. So it's also kind of like a vacation in that way.
What kind of sailboat racing do you do? What kind of boat do you compete in? What type of racing?
Yeah, I race in a J80 sailboat. So if there's racers out there, they know it's a very famous boat. Where I live, I race out of Kingston and we have what's called perf racing. So we race against different style boats. I race with my dad, who's 76 years old, and he taught me how to sail growing up. So that's very special. And we have just loaned our J80 to the J80 World Championships, which are happening in October in Newport, Rhode Island. So our boat is about to get a whole overhaul. And so I won't be racing again until the spring, but I'm very excited to be, you know, making connections in this other community, which is always, you know, sailors and business people, great crossover, because sailors are always like smart, creative, they like a challenge, friendly people. And I feel like and there's a lot of crossover with entrepreneurs specifically, like brave, smart, ready to think through problems, right? They like a challenge. If you didn't want a challenge, you wouldn't have a sailboat.
Love it. Let's do the plug section here, and then we're going to go down fun street, Sarah. Share with the listeners all the places people can find you, learn about your programs, websites, URLs, socials. We'll put it all in the show notes, but it always gets more engagement when they hear it from you.
Awesome. Well, the best central hub is PivotGround.com. That's my website, PivotGround.com. Pretty easy to spell. You can look me up on Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn. I go live here and there. I'm usually on LinkedIn the most these days. And I'd love to hear from people. You can sign up for my newsletter, which I deliver every week these days. And my main offering is called Thrive. So if you are a nonprofit or you love a nonprofit and you're like, I want to thrive, which, you know, the funny thing is in the for-profit world, we have such of this like abundance mindset, right? Like we can make the world better and make lots of money. The nonprofit struggles with that. And they've never been told that thriving was an option for them, that that delivering their work doesn't have to feel so hard. And it doesn't have to feel like you're, you know, just torturing yourself or bleeding for your cause, right? You can also make money and be joyful and make the world a better place with a nonprofit. So if that sounds exciting, come to pivotground.com, check out the Thrive program. And you can have a conversation with me too, if you want.
We love the name of this program. We
of course
think that's
you
a good thing. Everyone check that out. Sarah, are you ready to go down Fun Street? Listeners need to understand, she's like giggling and laughing. This is Fun Street for her the whole time. So, but we're going to make a specific commitment down a certain road here. Okay, this is a first, listeners. Share with the listeners the movie that you shared with me is one of your all-time favorite movies and the reasoning behind it, because I had not heard of this movie. I had to go look it up. And now I'd love to hear a little bit more about why it connects with you.
Sure. So there's this movie, Lost Horizon. It's from the 30s. And I grew up watching this movie, and parts of this movie, the film was lost, but the audio was saved. And so one of the things that always stood out to me and made me remember it is there are scenes where they just took still photos and kept the audio running, which is kind of unusual. I've never seen another movie do that. But the story of this movie is this plane is escaping war, and there's a journalist, there's all these characters, right? And it crashes in the Himalayas, and crashes because the pilot was like killed and taken over by someone else. It crashes in the Himalayas, and they get rescued by some mystery people and taken into this beautiful valley hidden in the mountains where everything's peaceful. It is Shangri-La, and there's plenty of food, and everyone's happy, and nobody ages. And it's just, it's a beautiful story. You then watch the various characters adapt to this environment. And some of them love it, and some of them don't trust it. Some of them want out of there. This has got to be fake. Some of them want they want to bring this to the rest of the world. And it's a lovely story of the drama of just human life and thinking about what perfection, what joy means to you, and how do you find that with some fun adventure thrown in.
I like it. And I will have to check it out. That is pretty cool, though, but they lost some of the video footage and used stills or pictures to do that. That's pretty ingenious, by the way, to keep it going, I guess. We got to make this film. We're just throwing some stills over here. That'll work. At least they didn't do like stick figures or animation. That would have been a little weird. All right, we're going to go down the speed round of Fun Street, Sarah. This is how this rolls. I'm going to ask you something. I want the first thing that comes to your mind. These are things that lift you up, motivate you, make you feel good. They basically make you thrive. Okay.
Got it.
Ready. Of late, a song that you love to listen to or one that pumps you up?
Oh, from Guardians of the Galaxy, come and get your love. I love that song.
That is an amazing soundtrack, by the way. Both movies, and I think there's a third one coming out too. Amazing, amazing, amazing soundtrack. You could listen to that all day long. Really, it's like the best of the best. And his little Walkman too, which makes it even fun. Okay, a favorite food that is not a dessert.
Oh, I have so many favorite foods. I love food. I love cooking. I love.
Well, let's go with that. So what do you love to eat? You say salmon is what you love to eat.
Smoked salmon. I love vegetables. I grew up, my mom has a 5,000 square foot vegetable garden. You know, some people go to like the farmer's market. I just put in orders with my mom. What do I want her to grow? and I grew up with this love of vegetables. I'll cook anything from around the world These days, I'm super allergic to gluten. So it's always interesting to find, you know, new things. And I've been allergic to gluten quite a while now, so I'm pretty good at it. But I've traveled a lot around the world. I love collecting spices and recipes when I travel, especially if I can get into some like housewives, that's a little sexist, but it's true in much of the world. If I can get into somebody's kitchen, like home kitchen, and get them to teach me a family recipe, I love that. I love just exploring flavor combinations.
Very cool. A favorite dessert?
Oh, favorite dessert. Probably like all of them. Cheesecake, always a winner. For the first time, I go through desserts that I perfect baking. I've just started on a new dessert journey of a French galette, which is where the king cake from New Orleans originated from. And it's like puff pastry with like an almond cream filling. So I've made my first one gluten-free and now I'm off to make a few new variations.
All right. An activity you wish you did more of?
I always wish I did more sailing. I know that's probably the one. I hang out with my kid whenever he's, I have a very smart, challenging 9-year-old. When he's like with it and into doing something with me, we have a great time. So I always look for more of those times when he's not resisting what we're doing.
Activity you wish you did less of?
Oh, activity I wish I did less of. You know, I've been pretty good at eliminating things I don't like. I had to bring in my water softener salt the other day, and carrying those 40-pound bags of water softener salt, definitely not my favorite.
Yeah, that would be on a list of things you would not want to do more often. Totally. carrying heavy things. I totally
they're heavy and they're like coated in that like salt kind of on the outside of the bag, and it gets all on your hands and your body. And then it's like you were in the ocean, but not doing anything fun.
Sarah, 2-part question to our final speed round question. If I could snap my fingers and you could be anywhere in the world, where would you be?
Oh, the Caribbean, I think, in the winter up here in New York.
And if you could sail anywhere, any particular location, maybe in a race or something, just to be out on the boat, where would that be?
Oh, well, the terrifying answer is I would love to get into some really more competitive races with more competitive racers and challenge myself. Man, is that terrifying? Like, I'm going to do it. But, you know, we have those things that we're like, oh, this will be so fun and I'll do it in a second. And then those things that like, you know, you want to do and you know, they're good for you, but you're gonna have to really psych yourself up to do it. And
so we're going to, what race would that be? Give us a race and a milestone that you'd be like.
So I think just competing in any of the J80 class association races, right, where you're racing all against and I don't know how good I am compared to some of the other racers. So
the only way to find out.
Something that was hard, right? Get in there and see how we do. A little benchmark activity.
I like it. Sarah Olivieri, everybody check it out. The Impact Method, Pivot Ground. Thank you so much for coming on the program. And hey, she's showing people how to get a little more organized and take a little of the profits out of business into the nonprofit world. I like that. You're making
things
a little bit more systematized.
You know, the nonprofit world has a lot to teach the for-profit world, because if you really master the complex business model of a nonprofit, the rest of for-profit work is easy peasy.
Thank you for coming on the program today, Sarah.
Thank you.
And to all the listeners out there, thank you for joining us. And until next time, keep moving onward and upward. And remember, be brief, be bright, be gone.
You've been listening to Thrive Loud with your host, Lou Diamond. Check us out on the web at thriveloud.com and follow us on Instagram, LinkedIn, Twitter, and Facebook at Thrive Loud. And check us out on the Good Pods app at Thrive Loud, where you can follow, listen, and connect directly to Lou and all of the Thrive Loud episodes. Thanks for listening.